In this lesson, we will learn how to move from Jupyter Notebook to VS Code. We will first see what are the cons of using Jupyter Notebook and why we need to move to VS Code. And then we will also see what are the cons of VS Code. And finally, we will see in details how to install VS Code and how to enable and add the Jupyter Notebook extension. So what are the cons of using Jupyter Notebook? First, we didn't have any debugging tools. So whenever we wanted to trace the code or to see what was the problem in the code because of exceptions or logical error, we needed to print the value of this variable each time and trace it. And this manual work is not recommended at all if you are working on a larger project. So we need to have debugging tools and breakpoints. Second, we didn't have a syntax error detector. So we needed to run the code. And then if there is a syntax error, it will be thrown in our face. While as we saw in the IDEs and code editors, we had syntax error detectors that can help us detect syntax errors before we even run the code. The third problem with Jupyter Notebook is that it's hard to manage with larger projects. So whenever you are working with a larger project and you have many files in this project, it can be a little bit hard to maintain your work and to see what's happening in other codes and so on. So we need a project manager, and code editors and IDEs are excellent for managing projects. Finally, you need to understand that Jupyter Notebook is only for development purposes, for educational purposes, to understand what's happening and to learn. But if you are working towards production environment, if you need to get this project deployed, then you will need to have an IDE or a code editor that supports deployment and production workflow. So what are the cons of using VS Code? First, by default, VS Code is not interactive. You can install and add extensions to add this interactivity and to have a better experience while using VS Code. Also in VS Code, we cannot run only snippets of the code. So if we have one lines of code, we cannot run 20 lines, for example. We need to run the whole 100 lines and see what is the output of these 100 lines. This is in contrast to Jupyter Notebook, where we could run 10 lines, for example, by writing these 10 lines in a code cell and run this code cell by itself. So as we see, we have some cons for VS Code and some cons for Jupyter Notebook. So let's see now how we can run Jupyter Notebooks in VS Code. So let's start from the very beginning. Let's download VS Code for Windows by clicking here. If we click here, the VS Code will start downloading. So we have downloaded VS Code. Let's install it. This is the setup widget for VS Code. It's pretty simple. We just click I accept the agreement, next, and then next, next. So we click next also, and then install. So once it's finished, we can click finish and it will launch VS Code. So once it's finished, this will open. We have this welcome message, right? And we can start new file, open folder, add workspace folder. We can customize. So let's go to customization. Here we can install Python tools or other programming languages tools. So let's click on this. And here you will see that we are in the marketplace, the extension in the marketplace. We can install Python extension. I have already installed it. So if we click on this, you see that more than 26 million people downloaded and installed the extension of Python. And here you can see all the details about how you can install it, how you can add it, and so on. So as a quick setup, you just install a supported version of Python on your system and then install the Python extension for VS Code, open or create Python file and start code. That's it. If you want to set up your environment, then you select your Python interpreter by clicking on the status bar just like this when we open the code. If we want to configure the debugger, because we have a debugger in Python here and it's really, really helpful when we are working, we can do this through the debug activity bar from here. We can also configure tests by running the configure test command right here, and that's by clicking on F2 on your keyboard, and then you can write any command in VS Code. So we can write the command configure tests to configure our tests in Python. So let's start with writing a very, very basic Python code, and then we will see how we can create or open a Jupyter Notebook file and how to start coding in our notebook editor. And from here also you can see that there are some useful commands that you can use, so you don't really need to remember these commands. And we also have some useful commands here for you to get started. For example, select the interpreter, because sometimes you might have more than one interpreter, so you can switch between them. You can also run Python files in terminal if you want, from run Python files in terminal command, format document, configure tests, and so on. So what are the main features of this Python extension? First, we have the entity sense we talked about, linting, so you have some additional code analysis, code formatting, it will format your code for you, debugging, so you have the debugging tools, the testing tools, the Jupyter notebooks are already there, the environment, you can switch between environment or create virtual environments, you can refactor your code, and we will talk about refactoring the code, and many more features. So what are these? We have first the explorer. When we open a new file, for example, if we come here and just create new file, we have this new file opened. If we want to save it anywhere, we can just save it anywhere we want. So let's say we want to save it in desktop, in VS Code inside desktop. And we want to have this file as Python file. So we will create it as test.py, for example, right? So we have test.py, and you see it now with this logo, so we know it's a Python file. And you see here that VS Code now has this test.py. So if we write any code, so let's say x equal 1, 2, 3, right? And then let's say for I in range x, print I. So what happened here? Let's start to understand what's happening step by step. First, as you see, when we open, if we just write x equal and then open brackets, you will see that the second bracket was opened automatically for you. And then when you write 1 and then a, for example, and then 3.4, you will see that all integers and floats are highlighted for you. And if you just hover over one of the variables, you will see that 3.5 type flow. If we hover over 1, it will say that's int, and so on, right? Now, if we want to loop over these variables, right, so let's remove this line. If we want to loop over this list, we will write 4, right, and you'll see auto completion. So if we just write f, it will tell you that we have filter, float, for, format, and so on. So if we just write fo, then it will tell you we have 4. So if you click enter, it will complete it for you, and you will see it now colored in purple. And then we can write I and then n, and once we write r, you will see that range is automatically suggested for us. So we can click enter also and then open the brackets, and now it will tell us a documentation about the range function. So it will tell us this is the stop parameter and it should be integer, and we can use the range function also by specifying the start, the stop, and the step. And this function return an object that produces a sequence of integers from start inclusive to stop exclusive by step. So this is the whole documentation for the range function. So if we write 1 and then 5, it will do so. So let's just write x, okay? And now we have this variable x stored, and if we hover over it, it will say that it's a list of type list. So we don't really need to print the type of the variable in order to know what is its type. And then we write colon. After that, when we click enter, you will see that the indentation was done automatically for you. If we write print, just br and then auto completion, open the brackets, you will see the whole documentation of the print function we saw before on the official Python documentation. So everything here, you don't really need to go to documentation to understand how this function works. So if we print I, and let's remove these two lines. So now we understand what's happening in these three lines. And you see also this red cycle. This is the breakpoint I was talking about. And we will see right now how we can use it. But also you can see here in the outline that we have I and we have X. If we click on I, it will go to where I is defined. If you click on X here, it will go to where X is defined. So if we have thousands of lines and you have all the variables here, and it will tell you where these variables are defined. Also, you can change the indentation by clicking here. This will open and you can indent using spaces or indent using tabs. So you can convert the indentation in the whole file to spaces or to tabs. Also, we can see the line number, right? So if we just hover here, you will see that line 3, column 1. So how to run this file? How to run this script? It's now a Python script, right? From here, you see this, run Python file in terminal. If we click on it, we will see there is an error saying list object cannot be interpreted as integer in line 3. Why? Because we cannot loop over the range of x. We need to loop over x, right? So if we do this and run again, we will see the output printed as 1a and 3.4. Okay, so it's like we are running the code in the terminal. We are just writing it here, and then we click here, so we run the code in terminal. There is also another way to run this code by going to run and then start debugging. Here we need to select a debug configuration. So we'll choose Python file, and we have here 1a and 3.4. If we want to debug the code and trace the output, so if we have a breakpoint here, and you can also have a breakpoint for exceptions, okay, and then run and debug Python file, you will see the code stopped here. And we see here that we have variables, locals, special variables. Let's ignore this for now. But we have the other variables are I, and we see now that for the first iteration, the value of I is 1. Now, here we have continue. And we have step over, we have step into, we have step out, and we have restart and stop. So if we click continue, we see now the value of I is A. And then if we click continue again, we have the value of I as 3.4. If we click continue again, then the code has finished. So this is a super useful way to debug the code. Just put a breakpoint where you are suspecting there is a problem, or in the place you want to trace the code, and then you have, as we saw on the left hand side, we have the debugger and we can trace the code as long as we want. Now, what are the other things here? First, we have the search. We can search throughout the code, and we can replace also. So if we search for x and then we replace each x with y, for example, and then choose replace all, replace, that's it. We changed every x in the code to y. It can be super useful when you did a mistake and you want to change a variable name, or if you want to search for a variable name. In the third tool here, we have source control, so you can create a repo or you can publish your work by Git to GitHub. And then we have the debugger that we just saw. This is the fourth tool here. And then we have the extensions, and the extensions, if we just remove this, we have hundreds of thousands of extensions that we can install. So if you search by most popular, for example, you will see the most popular extensions here. We have Python, C and C++, C Sharp, Live Server, and so on. So for example, we have Visual Studio, IntelliCode, we can install it. How we can install an extension from here? Just click install. We see that this extension has been installed 7 million times, and now it's installed. That's it. So it's installed, enabled. You don't really need to do any more work. It's as simple as that. We can also test our code by going to test and change from Java to Python. We can also have live share if we want to share our code with other people and they can see what we are doing live. And then if we have other extensions, for example, I have here Docker, we can also have the most popular extensions here, so we can access them pretty easily. And this toolbar, we have very, very simple stuff. So if we need to create a new file, if we want to undo something we did, if we want to find and replace, if we want to select everything in the code, if we want to run the code, if we want to run in the terminal, if we want to see some help on some specific function or tips and tricks in VS Code, and so on. So as we see, VS Code is very, very, very simple, yet it's very, very powerful. I think this is enough information for one lesson. In the next lesson, we will see how we can use Jupyter Notebook inside VS Code.